All right. Great. Well, let's quickly recap. I'm sure by now you would have known that the structure of the papers have changed. So we won't be doing climatology and weather, but in your final exams, you will be writing two papers over two consecutive days, however, not directly after each other. And question one will be on your climatology and weather. And question two is what we will be doing this afternoon is the geomorphology. Now, the geomorphology question two, is by far the poorest answer question historically. So I'm hoping to get you out of your misery this afternoon. So that will total to 60 marks, and then 60 marks for question one. And then you will have question three, your map work. Now, grade 12s with a map work, now you have to really know your content because it's 30 marks that will link to your theory. You will have your skills and calculations and then your applications. And 9 out of 10 times, the GIS, you also struggle with that question. It's 8 marks, and it's the easiest 8 marks that you can get if you know your theory. And you know how to interpret the map. But that won't be my focus today. My focus will be to help you with question two in your paper one, the geomorphology. I'll just quickly browse over to the structure of paper two, that's the human geography. So by now, you should have done settlement. You had to be tested on it in your June exam. And then question two will be on the economics of South Africa. And there you have to be very careful because certain topics have been prescribed, and I'm sure your teachers will know exactly what to do. And also then your map work. And then very important in both of these papers, you will have one paragraph type question in each of the questions. In paper one and paper two, question one and question two. And then also your definitions, and we'll cover some concepts this afternoon. Those are all 2 marks. So just by knowing a concept, you will know that you will have 2 marks. It's a foolproof way of knowing that you have 2 marks. And then also what I'm going to do next is just go over the structure of the papers and how geographer exam setters look at the content. And then they decide, okay, how can we test our learners? And I'm hoping that after today, we will be able to get into the minds of those examiners, and not be caught out by them and not be caught unaware when we write our paper one. So what they do is every single exam paper, and this is important because if you know your work and you know what is expected, then you won't be stressed, and then geography becomes so easy. So every single question paper consists of 25% lower order, your middle order, this is your understanding and application, and then the higher order questions, like your paragraph questions and questions where you have to analyze, and evaluate. Those are considered your higher order questions. So let's quickly have a look at your lower order questions. Those will most likely be 1 mark questions. For example, name 3 drainage patterns, or give the stream order at X, define the term confluence, identify the watershed in the diagram. And then maybe list a few factors that influence drainage density, for example. Then when you have to understand and apply, those are questions such as discuss, explain. Now, before I go further, with middle order and higher order questions, something such as discuss why. Let's think about a question, discuss why a captured stream will have a higher velocity. In other words, why will that river flow faster after it captured another river? So now you have to discuss why. And these discuss why questions and explain why questions, they have led to something I'm not a fan of. And it's part marking, where your question has to be answered in twofold. So there you have to give a statement and then a qualifier. So for example, the river will have higher erosion properties because it now has the velocity of the captured stream. So there's your statement and your qualifier. I know life orientation also requires a statement and a qualifier. Now, a lot of the learners that I tutor have asked, but ma'am, it steals our time. No, it doesn't, because you have 3 hours for this paper. So the moment you see a discuss why question, use a pen or a pencil or a highlighter and write there, I need to write two things. I need to give a statement and I need to give the qualifier. A question such as show, illustrate, or describe. Have a look at what they give you and then read the full question. Grade 12s, read that question 4 times and make sure that you understand what they expect of you. What do these examiners need from me and how will I get my marks? If you have to illustrate, they sometimes ask you to illustrate by means of an annotated sketch. And what I've done is I've taken some of the questions that I've used where my grade 12s really tripped and fell on their faces. And it was actually such an easy question that they didn't read because I asked for annotated and they never wrote any labels. So the moment you illustrate, you have to be able to draw everything in geography in such a way that a person with zero geographical knowledge will be able to know exactly what's going on. It's kind of like an architect's blueprint as to how this building is going to come and form its shape. So that's very important. A question such as describe can also be describe why, although I can't recall seeing a describe why question, but I'm well aware of discuss how, discuss why, explain how, explain why. Moving on to the higher order questions, when you have to analyze and evaluate, you can also be asked evaluate why. So rather give us more to read and more to mark, but just be careful that you don't start waffling. Because sometimes you will go on a tangent and then all of a sudden we are reading the same fact 7 times all over. And unfortunately, we can only credit you with marks for one of the 7 repetitive facts. So evaluate, justify, predict, assess, construct, and argue. Predict what might happen to the agriculture along the captured river. Now it's very important to note that there's a difference between the captor, the pirate, and the poor soul that gets pirated. So the robber and the person, the victim. But we'll get to that just in a short time. One thing that I really want us to, and I've actually moved the slide a little bit further, is when you study geomorphology. Let me just quickly get all the animations out the way. There we go. If you study something such as drainage patterns, know the questions that geographers ask because examiners look at these exact questions. Here's a map and a diagram of a nice drainage basin. What can we ask? So the what is it question is, identify this feature. There we go. It's 1 mark. It's what is it? It's a drainage basin. Where is it? So now they can ask that by means of a map, for example. Your drainage basins will most likely be there where most rainfall falls, and so on and so forth. Why is it there? A question also with geomorphology is why is the river exactly there where it is? What does it look like? Is it a perennial river? Is it a non-perennial river? Is it an exotic river? So let's have a look at the next question. What happened? So in geomorphology, the question, what happened, is, for example, what happened to this river? Why is the river a misfit stream? If we move on to the next one, what is the impact of that misfit stream on agriculture, on the economy of the people along that river? We can also ask what happened. It's the captor stream. So the captor stream, captures the other stream. So for example, now the captor stream is rejuvenated. It's got more. And I always explain this by means of a robber. You've taken someone else's money. Now you can do more. So you can be, the river can be more erosive. The river can flow faster. And then the other poor soul that does not have any money, he can't buy bread, for example. So livelihood goes down. Quality of living goes down. How can it be managed? That's also something that you now need to look at. What can we do? So with geomorphology and river cap catchment areas, how can we manage those areas? So again, the moment you know these questions, you can literally have a look at every single topic and content that you have to study for all, for both of your papers. Every single topic can be linked and almost bound together by means of these questions. Right, example of a question. So this is just an example that they tell us that figure 1.6 shows river erosion. So again, what is it? What type of erosion is associated? What evidence indicates? Identify why. And then in a paragraph of approximately 8 lines, explain how river rejuvenation could change the fluvial features downstream. So you can see that the first three questions, they were just one markers. Question 1.6.4 is for 4 marks. So therefore, you had to give 2 facts worthy of 2 marks. Why is rejuvenated land not suitable for human activity? And then in the paragraph, explain how it would change the features. So then we jump from a 4 times 2. Therefore, you have all your cognitive orders, your low, middle, and higher order in this question. You will have 3 types of questions in your exam. These questions will range from short questions, 1 markers, data response questions, questions that will range from a diagram or a photo, and then your paragraph questions. So you have to know how to deal with each of these different types of questions. What I normally do is, especially with short questions, your multiple choice, is I used to completely put my hand over the options that they gave us and write down the answer that comes to your mind first. And then I go and look for my answer in the options that they've provided with us. The data response questions, they will give you the data and you have to look for the answers and use the data to help you in your answering of the questions. And then the paragraph type questions, there's a slide that follows pretty soon where we will unpack the paragraph question so that you guys will know exactly what is it that these people want from me and what do I need to provide them with. Right, so the structure, you will have short questions, 7 or 8 marks. Either choose the correct answer, refer to the diagram, match the columns, choose one item from the list, multiple choice, and then direct short questions. These questions, I always tell my learners that these questions are sometimes so easy that just by looking at them, you will know the answer. I also have something that I will share on the WhatsApp group, just a way, a different way that I've picked up that examiners are asking these short questions It's a table form, but they give us diagrams. So I've made it a PDF, and I will share it on the WhatsApp group pretty soon. These are just the questions that you need to know again. Very important. Right, your paragraph type questions. Now you need to think. The length of the answer is 8 lines, and a lot of the time learners write a page and a half, and they get those 8 marks within the first 6 lines. So you are wasting your time that you could have used for map work. Sentences, paragraph questions, apologies, in geography, we do not use bullets. We use full sentences, no one word answers, and it's straight and to the point. Right, how many parts? Now, if you recall, I've mentioned explain how, explain why. Sometimes they will ask you the impact. Impact can both be positive or negative. If they ask for socio-economic, I mean, we are interacting with each other via social media, people. And then economic, we've seen it recently after the elections, how South Africa's economy. And from today onwards, petrol is cheaper. So it's how the people and their money is impacted, how the people and their livelihoods are impacted. So sometimes you have to give mentioning to two parts that you have to refer to. Underline the main topic. Geography has got various action words, and then also the focus area. You can't, for example, mention something such as flooding from a mid-latitudinal cyclone in a geomorphology question. However, the flooding might be that the river is a non-perennial river and it only flows during rainy seasons. So, and then the rainy season might be in winter when we experience our mid-latitudinal cyclones, or how we refer to it in the Western Cape, cold fronts, and therefore flooding occurred. But remember, question one, climatology, question two, geomorphology. Then use the source. A lot of the times, the paragraph type questions stem from the source that we give you. And very important, you have to apply what the question asks, what you have learned, what you know, and apply it to the question and the topic that is given in the question paper. An example, just quickly, on that is maybe they give you a diagram of a graded river, and then they ask you what will the impact be if farmers construct a dam along the course of the river. So now you can't just go and say it will decrease the river velocity and habitats and so on and so forth. Have a look at maybe they've got settlements further down the river on the diagram, and use the diagram in your answer. Grade 12s, I'm going to interrupt myself there. There's a reason why you have either infographic or a diagram or a photo or a map, because the examiners, you might hate your teachers, but with the sources that we give you, we are trying to help you. And I'll be first to admit that my learners always hate me when they walk out of the examination room. And then when we go over the paper, I said, but guys, have a look at the source. And then they just look at me and shake their heads. So use the source. However, you cannot, unless they ask you, you cannot rewrite the entire reading piece as an answer. You won't get marks unless they ask you to, according to the article, according to the infographic. Right. Let's move along. How do we unpack a paragraph type question? So here's a paragraph question that's quite loaded. They ask us to write a paragraph of approximately 8 lines to describe the human and environmental impacts of the mid-latitudinal cyclone on agricultural activities. Oh, so now let's have a look here. Let me just get my laser pointer. There we go. So now we have to look at the human and environmental impacts. Impacts, they don't ask for positive or negative, of the mid-latitudinal cyclone on the humans and the environment, and then also agriculture. So with agricultural, what happens to the humans and what happens to the environment? Very important, it's a paragraph, so therefore you use full sentences, 8 lines, not 8 pages. You have to list and account for the main characteristics. It is describe. Then part 1 of your answer is the human aspect. Part 2 is environmental impacts. They did not specify, therefore we have to include both. On a mid-latitudinal cyclone on agricultural activity. So specifically crop farming and livestock. All right. Therefore, you have to be very careful as to when you write bridges will or infrastructure will be broken down. Infrastructure will be negatively impacted. So infrastructure is damaged. Therefore, the farmer cannot go to his crops. Therefore, the farmer cannot reach the livestock. So the focus has to be on agricultural activities. Very important. Please do not make that mistake. You guys normally just see mid-latitudinal cyclone and there you go, guns blazing, and it's snow and it's flooding and low-lying areas and bridges are overflowing and bridges are damaged. But what do we ask you? Agricultural activities. Right, so for example, this question. In a paragraph of 8 lines, explain the impact, positive and negative, of bergwind conditions on the physical or then your natural environment. So let's have a look at the answers. Very, very, very important. Plants dry out due to the hot winds. So in this paragraph, you will see this is 2021. And if I don't, I think from 2021, this is where part marking also surfaced. So all of these answers link to negative impacts. And then only over here, the ash of the felt fires can act as fertilizers for the development and growth of new vegetation, and then felt fires can promote seed germination. Now, those of you that can see Table Mountain, recently we had a lot of fires on Table Mountain, and within a few weeks, the proteas and the fynbos, they start new growth. So we first get the negative from these bergwind conditions, the fact that they can fuel and basically increase the impact of bergwind conditions with those runaway felt fires. However, with a felt fire, there is a positive. Okay, so there aren't many positives of bergwind conditions. So bergwinds are those warm winds that we feel normally just before a cold front approaches. So very, very, very important. It's explain the impact on the natural environment. So you can't give mention to with the wind, now the people will have dust all over their homes. Mm-mm. It is not the physical or the natural environment. Let's move along. An infographic. Now, grade 12s, an infographic to me is the best cheat sheet. So In maths lit and in maths sometimes they allow learners, and I think physics also, almost like a formula sheet. And an infographic in geography is exactly that. You will have your topic, which is the main tree, and then you will have certain images, a text, a graph, or even a map to show you more about the topic. There's a lovely example that follows. So there you can see it's a profile of a car guard. They have a graph and they have a reading piece. So when you start your question papers at the end of the year, there has to be 10 minutes reading time. And I would like to encourage you to use the 10 minutes wisely. Make mental notes such as, hang on page 4, I have to read, there's a photo, and they also provide us with a graph, a visual aid. A lot of the time I refer to English and Afrikaans, where you have to look at the car guard's face. Look, what is the car guard trying to tell you? Does this individual look angry? Does he look hungry? Is it a fat guy and a thin guy? And then a lot of the time it's all the Shakespeare where it's the king and the queen and the whatever, and then the peasants. So have a look at what we present you with. So I'm going to hopefully cement the fact that a lot of the answers are right in front of you in geography. So there we have our first aspect of an infographic. It's our short text. Then we have the image plus additional information. And then you have your graph. So the questions that stemmed from this, we first have to give an idea or get an idea what this infographic as a whole is trying to tell you. So the main topic is the livelihood of the informal sector. So again, this won't be in your geomorphology question, however, it will be in paper two. So they tell us what a car guard is. They tell us that a lot of South Africans are unemployed. They tell us that foreigners come to South Africa, but they struggle to find employment. There they have the average age, the average income, and then the risks and the challenges. So a lot of the time, the questions will also then stem from these. The different types of information, this I've done. So just have a look at where, so it says the average income per day, 98 rand and 33 cents, and this is the biggest challenge. Of the 25 car guards, roughly 23 of them said that their low income is their biggest risk. Over here, they say car guarding is an opportunity through which many people may be able to learn or earn, apologies, at least some income. And there they link it to the photo. Another one that we've given here is climatology. Give one evidence that the tropical cyclone is in the southern hemisphere. Now, let's just have a look at what we have here. We have Madagascar. And we have Mozambique. And then have a look over here. You have a small extract of the continent of Africa showing us the area impacted by Tropical Cyclone Eloise. If you read the news, Hurricane Beryl is wreaking havoc in America. I think. It's expected to reach Jamaica today. I was a bit out of reception and out of radio for the last 2 days, so I have not checked in as to where good old Beryl is. But Beryl will most likely have different questions than Eloise. They ask us to state two weather conditions associated with tropical cyclones in the infographic. So we know that it brings flooding. We know that it brings high winds. We know that people are displaced. But what are they giving us in the infographic? They ask us to give one reason for the decrease in wind speed from the 19th of January to the 20th of January 2021. What can we see on this diagram? 19th of January, it was still east of Madagascar. Through the course of the evening, it went over Madagascar, therefore it lost its friction and it had to deal with a lot of ground and trees and infrastructure. So therefore the wind speed decreased. Account for the increase in wind speed from 20 to 22 July. And what happened from 20 to 22? Eloise proceeded through the Mozambique Channel. What do we know about this channel over here? It's got warm waters. Another question, according to the infographic, the negative impact of Tropical Cyclone Eloise was devastating. Suggest three strategies that could be put in place to reduce the impact. Now you have to go and look at what was the impact. People were displaced. Sadly, we had loss of lives. People were injured. Houses were destroyed. They were damaged. They were flooded. Impassable roads. People had to get somewhere. Emergency services might have struggled to get somewhere. In the text, they say that it came up with winds of 140 kilometers. Goodness gracious, my car sounds like, I don't know, a hurricane is hitting it at 120. So I'm not even sure I can reach the speed of Eloise's wind speed here. It also caused heavy rainfall with 250 millimeters of rain. So that's just shy of your normal 30 centimeter ruler in water that reached Madagascar and then also Mozambique, which we know as an area not really well developed with regards to infrastructure. And then they say in the text, as well as in your table, that Eloise's landfall resulted in thousands of displaced people. Right, so they give evidence that it's in that the tropical cyclone is in the southern hemisphere. It said that it made landfall in Beira in Mozambique. It shows us Mozambique, it shows us Madagascar, and it shows us the southern part of Africa, which goes without even saying we are in the southern hemisphere. They ask us to state two weather conditions associated. So there again with the infographic, it came with winds and then heavy rainfall. Give one reason for the decrease in wind speed. It moved over Madagascar. Account for the increase. It traveled across the Mozambique Channel. And then according to the infographic, suggest the three strategies that could be put in place to reduce this impact. Then again, this is your cheat sheet. All five of those questions can be guided by means of this infographic. Okay, so let's have a look. This looks like a repeat. There we go. Okay, now we can finally start with geomorphology. Mr. Ferreira, are there any questions thus far?
I checked in the group now and there's no questions posed yet, ma'am.
Okay, all right, awesome. Thank you very much, sir. Right, so
Okay.
grade 12s with, ooh, sorry. Okay, so with your geomorphology topics, you will have the different drainage basins in South Africa, fluvial processes, and then the catchment and river management. Now, I doubt that we'll get through everything today. What we have to mention with geomorphology, that the dreaded map work links very well with the dreaded geomorphology. However, the answers are always in front of you. Let's have a look. The different drainage basins in South Africa. Now, grade 12s, this is something that you need to know. You need to know what is a watershed. What is the source of the river? What is a tributary? What is the confluence? Where can I find the confluence? And then where is the river mouth? Now, I'm very glad that this diagram is on the PowerPoint, because in the questions that I'm going to send to you, I have adapted this exact diagram. And a lot of my learners got floored with this question. Although I thought it's a lower order question. But then again, maybe they were a bit tired. So let's have a look. Every single concept, drainage basin, the catchment area, the river system, tributary, confluence, watershed, all of those on the left-hand side of the screen. I'm just checking. Yes, all of them have their definitions to the right. So very, very, very important. Let's say they ask you to identify, they change confluence and they label it C. They ask you to identify C. C will then be the confluence. That might be question, geomorphology is question 2, so it might be question 2.3.1. Then in question 2.3.2, they will ask you to define your concept or your answer, or to provide a definition for your answer in question 2.3.1. Now, let's say you've identified confluence, or C then, as a tributary. Grade 12s, unfortunately, now you would have lost 3 marks. So let's have a look at what they give us. The watershed, you can see that there's a dashed line, and it outlines the higher lying areas and then also goes straight to the ocean. So catchment area, area over which the rain falls and is caught by a drainage basin. So now we can have a look. This is the watershed. And what exactly is a watershed? It's the high-lying area separating two drainage basins. With confluence is the place where two rivers join. So now you can see that there's the source of the river. This river is the main one that I'm following with the laser pointer now. And then over here, you have your tributaries. There's a tributary. Over here is another one. And lastly, this one joins just before it enters the ocean at the river mouth. So between the source and the tributary over here, my learners struggled. But which one is highest? Okay, so there's the source of the river, where the river begins. The tributary is a river that joins a larger river. Now, this diagram is a little bit tricky because you can't really see a difference in width in this river. So therefore, you have to know, and I always say by trial and error, figure out what we are asking. So let's say C was the confluence, and then question 2.3.2 would be the definition. And then from there, they will ask, let's say, the stream order, maybe if they've given a different diagram. But I'll show you on the WhatsApp. I've tried to make the document how can I say that it won't steal all your data? I know it's only the 4th of July, so I do not want to see fireworks and raging people that my sources and my additional help depleted your data. I did try to compress the file a little bit. Okay, let's carry on. Right, this is a question that was asked in last year's exam. And before we even look at the questions, I want us to have a look at what are these people giving me? What am I being presented with? So there they tell us that the dotted line is a river system boundary. And within this area, how can I say, outlined by the dotted lines, you can see rivers joining a main river. There's the water table. Okay, so it's the line and the two dots and the line and the dot dot. Then they indicate the sea and the sea. And then immediately you can see that, hang on. This has to be a mountain and that has to be a mountain. Therefore, high-lying areas, and then a river system boundary. So match the concepts below with the letters. Oh, goodness, go back. My apologies. Match the concepts below with the letters in the diagram. Let's see, 2.1.1, the source of the river. Which letter, Mr. Ferreira, maybe you can check the WhatsApp line. Which letter would you guys think is the source of the river? No one wants to give it a try. So which one of these letters indicates the start of the river? Don't leave me hanging. I'll give you a clue that you won't find it over here.
Nothing's coming through on the WhatsApp line.
I can see someone is typing, sir, but there's no answer coming. Oh, there we go. Is it Lisa Kanya? I hope that's the correct name. B. And I fully agree with you, Lisa Kanya, which means that this is where the river starts. So B is the source of the river. Thank you very much, my dear. So also, the next question, and I always laugh, because look at this. I sometimes doubt the intelligence of examiners. 2.1.2, now I'm also one because I set questions for my own learners. The water table, grade 12s, in the key, they give you water table. Line, dot, dot, line. And hello, line, dot, dot, line, dot, dot, line. And what's pointing? It's the letter G. So it's kind of like, hello, it's right there in front of you. Now, where's our interfluve? Let's see who knows their concepts. Our interfluve. So what is an interfluve? Can anyone tell me? I see Sake and Kylie said G. Yes, the water table is G. Thank you very much. 2.1.2 is G. And 2.1.3, the interfluve. What's an interfluve?
On the WhatsApp group, Q and Adam says it's D.
D. Q, are you sure you are not confused with the concept confluence? Have a look quickly. Everyone's saying D. If I recall, an interfluve is our higher lying areas separating two drainage basins. Mr. Ferrara, can you just check me on those facts? Because I don't agree with Lisa Kanya again. Is it Aliko, Connie? Ooh, goodness. Okay, so I can see you on my phone. Sake, Kylie, and is it Kama? I'm not sure. Don't laugh at me. I'm a woman, and we all know women claim that they can multitask, but can we? So now I'm seeing the correct answer, H. And why those a few learners that answered D? Why is D the confluence? Because D is pointing towards the area where two rivers join. And H is pointing to this higher lying area separating our two drainage basins. So now I've answered 2.1.4, the drainage basin. I do not want to insult you and ask the answer for 2.1.5 because the river mouth has to be E, as that's where this river flows into the sea or into the ocean. The watershed we've covered, that is C, the confluence we've covered, and then what will our process of infiltration be? Now again, infiltration is when water seeps into the soil. So water on the surface, and that's the reason why they've given us the water table. So what letter can we associate with 2.1.8? Okay, I'm seeing a lot of Fs. Semi-Liso, Leah, Magala is on 2.4. Abonga is at 2.8, and I agree with every single one of you who answered F. Okay, so what have they shown us? They've shown us the water on the surface, they've showed us the water table, and therefore infiltration occurs at the letter F. Any other further questions or queries on matching the concepts? And then hopefully we are roughly 40% into believing when I say that the answers are always, apologies, in front of you. Then the chat on the WhatsApp, you can just indicate if you are happy with those terms. And then also sometimes grade 12s, what I want to point out is a lot of the diagrams in questions, question 2.1 or 2.2 with your short questions, your 7 marks or your 8 marks questions. So that's a 7 times 1, where from 2.1.1 all the way to 2.1.8 is they're only worth 1 mark. And a lot of the times the diagrams in those questions will help you later on. So for example, let's say it's river management, or it's river capture, or it's drainage patterns, it's stream orders. So sometimes these diagrams are there to lead you and to guide you into the further questions. Right, now, this slide. I want you to pay very close attention to this slide, because I have a surprise up my sleeve and I want to help you, hopefully, with the answers to the questions that I'm going to post a little bit later. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to only do questions 1 to question 7. Was it 1? It's just the first 3 pages of the questions that were given to you. I don't have a hard copy in front of me, apologies. So the different types of rivers. Again, I repeat, pay close attention. So now you have to know the definition. You have to be able to identify and apply. So here we are presented with four types of rivers: permanent, periodic, and periodic rivers are also called our, episodic and then exotic. So everyone thinks that the Northern Cape has got plenty of water because of the Orange River. But the Orange River is an exotic area because it flows through the Northern Cape. A permanent river, water that flows all year round. And just look at how the name can guide you. It's permanent. It's there every single time you go and look at it. Periodic, the name itself, you have lessons, you have periods. So you change in between classes. So therefore, you'll only be in geography when you have the geography period. So in the interior of South Africa, those rivers will only flow in the rainy season. The other word that I couldn't get is your periodic would also be your non-perennial rivers. And your permanent river in map work would be your perennial river. Have a look at the key that they've given us. They have a wet season, which is the small grouped dashed or dotted line. The dry season are the longer lines, and then the arrows seeping into the river as base flow. So that is river that's infiltrated through the soil. Episodic, rivers only flow after heavy rain, and that's a lot of the time in our western plateau. So a lot of the times in the Northern Cape, they might experience a strong mid-latitudinal cyclone where the rainfall extends up into the Northern Cape, and then rivers literally. Farmers drove in that riverbed for 7 years, and then all of a sudden, after heavy rain, now it's a river. And I've witnessed rivers recently after good rains in the Northern Cape where they haven't flown for 13 to 15 years. And the people, they just go crazy. They go bonkers because it's something that they don't see. And the reason for that is that the infiltration and the soil was actually saturated for the first time in so many years. And those of you that know the Northern Cape, like they say in Afrikaans, daar's niks. There's absolutely nothing there. I have family from the Northern Cape, so they only have warm-hearted people and a few stones and lots of episodic and then periodic rivers. And then they also have, it seems like they only have rivers. They only have the exotic river called the Orange River. Right, so now, grade 12s, one thing that you also need to know is that a big thing for me when we try to test you is remember the questions a geographer ask. What is it? Where is it? Now, if you ask someone, what is it? You can either describe it, or you can mention it to someone, or if someone asks you, what is the best way to get from, let's go, Bellville to Canal Walk? Now, those of you who know the area, you can get to Canal Walk via the N1, or you can go down Voortrekker Road, or you can go on the N1, then go into Paro. You can buy a Coke at Elsie's River, and then you can go back past, past Grand West, and then from there you can also get on the N1. So you can also be asked to draw one of these rivers. So questions might be something in line of, by means of an annotated drawing, draw a periodic river. So have a look at the sketch that we have here. So they've got clouds there because it's only in the rainy season. They've got the tree there. And then you've got your water table in the wet season, in the dry season, the river won't have a flow because they did not experience any rainfall. And then if they do have a river, it is due to the infiltration. This one over here, your permanent river, have a look at that water table in the wet season and the dry season. That water table is above the riverbed. Therefore, that river will flow all year round. It's a permanent river. Right. Again, you have to be able to name the types of rivers. So what are the rivers? Describe the type of the river, provide examples of the river, and you need to know the height of the water table in these rivers. Also, rivers appear on maps. Whew. So you can be asked to identify the type of river, either perennial or non-perennial, a permanent or a periodic river, on your map. And if you know where they appear, the east coast of South Africa, the interior or the western plateau, you'll be able to, in your map work grade 12s, they have to give you background information. And with that background information comes a map of South Africa, and we are not allowed to give you any topographic map of any place other than in South Africa. So those maps have to be indicated, or the area where the map is taken from has to be indicated on the map of South Africa. And then you will also be able to see, is it along the east coast? Is it in the Durban, the KZN area? Is it, let's say it's a Bloemfontein map, or in the interior of South Africa, such as the Free State, the Western Plateau? It might be a map somewhere in the Northern Cape, Western Plateau, Cirrus area. Now I've had a plateau there with my cognitive capabilities. But this is what you need to know. And again, grade 12s, every single question comes, we won't just give you question 1.1.1. What is this? Question 1.1.2, define this. There's always something. An infographic, a graph, a photo, a table, something that you have to read before the rest of the questions follow. All right. Now, I've discussed quite a few of these things. So stream patterns, stream orders, longitudinal and cross profiles, our fluvial landforms, our stream piracy, and our rejuvenation. So let's have a look at the stream patterns. And if I'm not mistaken, everyone has been issued with the paper one, survival guide. So very important that you have to know is the different stream patterns. So I'm just quickly going to get all the animations. Right, so dendritic. I'm not sure if there are some learners that take life sciences. So dendrites, your axons and all of those, and the dendrites, they basically look like a dendritic pattern. So the dendritic pattern looks like a tree. So let's see if I can draw. So if I have to draw, there's my tree branch, and then boom, boom. I'm not a very good artist. I'm a geography teacher. But there we go. There's my tree, and I'll color in the trunk. So that's why we say that the dendritic looks like a tree. The rocks, now this is very important. And a lot of the time, the learners, you grasp the fact that it's dendritic. You know exactly how the shape looks, but you don't know the underlying structure. What is the reason as to why this river has a dendritic pattern? Let's have a look at trellis. It's alternating layers of hard and soft rock, and then parallel streams. So again, I'm not a fan of maths. Can you see that these lines, or rivers rather, are drawn parallel to each other? So the trellis, it's parallel streams. And the reason why the streams look like this is you might have softer rock here, harder rock, so rivers struggle to flow through the harder rock. Radial, I don't know why geography and maths have got so much in common. Radius of a circle, so from the highest central point. So in map work, this can be either Butte or Conical Hill, where the river will flow. So if I had to draw contour lines, I don't have brown here. So you would have your contour lines. Ooh, creases. This is a really bad drawing, but I hope you get the idea that from the center, and then the river will start to flow down the slope. I'm trying to draw my contour lines a little bit further. So there's my Conical Hill. Okay, so these rivers are going from a highest central point outward. Okay, then rectangular. These rivers bend at 90 degrees. So there's my 90 degree angle. The tributaries are also joining at a 90 degree angle. And the underlying rock structure here leads us to the answer that the reason for this rectangular stream pattern is that the rocks have got joints and faults. So you have to know what it looks like, what's the description, and then the underlying structures. And grade 12s, if you know what it looks like, you can draw it. Okay, so that's very important. Okay, so the link with the map work. Again, this is your dendritic one. It looks like the tree. The trellis, this is a very, very, very detailed trellis drainage or stream pattern, apologies, because you have your straight lines and then the rivers, okay, your tributaries. The rectangular one, can you see there's a 90 degree, 90 degree, okay, so therefore this is rectangular. And then the radial, so this is the famous Teibus, Cofibus and Teibus, your teachers will know from grade 11 work. And then this is what I try to draw. From the Conical Hill or the Butte, these rivers flow or they radiate down. Okay, so in order to identify there, you can see the height of the spot height at a height of 1,578 meters. And there's a benchmark, 1,237.9 meters. So therefore, they flow from a higher central point downwards. Right, the discharge of a river, laminar flow and turbulent flow. Now, I always explain this as if you laminate something, a poster or a photo, it's smooth. All right, so if you look at the photo on the screen currently, the photo on the left, water flows as parallel sheets. So it's not laminated sheets. It just means that there's nothing that obstructs the flow of the river. The riverbed is even. You can go, growing up on the farm, we used to take those big tractor tires, and mostly after heavy rains, we would go down the river on those tractor tires, but we would never go when the water was turbulent, or when the flow was turbulent. The laminar flow, that's just chilling, floating down the river. There's less erosion, and laminar flow you will find in the lower course of the river. There where the river has reached its old age stage. Now, I do not want to be rude and refer to this river as my mother because she's looking after my little baby currently. So she might just come into the room and hit me with a pan. However, in the lower course, things slow down. with the turbulent flow in the movies, when the aeroplanes are all shaken up. Recently, a guy unfortunately lost his life. I think it's a Singapore Airlines flight due to turbulence. So things are rough. Now, the adventure seekers, this is where they would go with their kayaks. So the water flow is turbulent. The riverbed is uneven. You will have lots of rocks and boulders in this river. There's more erosion because of that faster flow. And this you will find in the upper course. Why? In the upper course, the river is still young and destructive. So you can connect the dots there. If you have a little toddler running around, or even a teenager, they fast. And 9 out of 10 times, quite disruptive. So this you will find in the upper course, more erosion, your V-shaped valleys, your contour lines will be close together. You'll be able to see the mountain with the appearance of those brown contour lines. Right. Drainage densities. Now, grade 12s in map work, immediately, if you see a lot of blue on your map, either perennial rivers or non-perennial rivers, either your broken blue lines or your solid blue lines, the moment you have a lot of something, high density buildings, high density areas with regards to people, in comparison to low density. So the moment you have more rivers, you will have a high density in comparison to this section over here, a low density. So very important to know that in a high drainage density area, there's a reason for the amount of rivers there. Therefore, high rainfall. It can't be softer rocks because the water has a high density, therefore it's harder rocks, the steeper slopes, less vegetation, less infiltration. So due to the hard rocks, water won't infiltrate into the ground, less vegetation, so we do not have roots of the vegetation or of the plants to use the water. In a low density area, low rainfall, softer rocks, gentle slopes, lots of vegetation, and then more infiltration. Right, this is very important. So the word board over here, these are names that show the keywords, or the word board shows the keywords and concepts associated with different fluvial processes. So fluvial processes, erosion, deposition, and the profile of the river. So what we are going to look at now is the longitudinal and traverse or transverse profiles relating to the course of rivers. Now, these slides are nice and animated. So in the word board, we had fluvial processes and we had deposition. So what does the river look like? And then what is it? Can you see the repetition of the questions that geographers ask? So what is it? So fluvial stems from a Latin word, fluvius, which means river. So it's the physical interaction of flowing water and the natural channels of the rivers and streams. Processes, have a look at that animation. We start with a flat top and then that river carves its way through the valley. So it's kind of like a valley in a valley. So the process is a sequence of actions that shape and change the environment. Then deposition into the ocean. So I always say you deposit money. So that means the river loses its energy and drops or deposits some of the material that it is carrying. We will get to the different courses, but think about a river in the lower stage or the old age, the lower course or the old age stage, a lot of these people get rid of a lot of their things. They buy smaller houses. They move into a town that's not as fast paced. So they lose some of their energy. They become slower. The people in the shop after payday, and that auntie just does not want to move. And you try and go around her with a trolley. So it's deposition, losing energy and dropping deposits of its material. Right, again, erosion. Now, this animation, grade 12s, I absolutely love. So lateral erosion is then erosion sideways. So there you can see those arrows are going left and right. Headward erosion or backward erosion is a concept that we get to do with in river capture, where the stronger river or the capital river through headward erosion then captures another river, right? And then vertical is down. Okay, so there we have erosion. The river gradually removes and transports rock material from the riverbed and banks. So erosion is when weathered material is moved. If we can go back a few years to grade nines. Vertical erosion is the river erodes downwards, deepening that river channel. Lateral, when the river erodes sideways. So therefore, you will have a wider river valley. And then headward or backwards erosion is the river erodes upstream, therefore lengthening the river. The profile is, if you do art or you like drawing, is that's the profile of an individual. It's a side view. And then this would be an outline or representation of that river. So the profile, apologies, is not to be confused with a cross section. Right, longitudinal and transverse profiles of a river. So again, the profile is how we look at this river from the side. So there we can see the source, the start of the river, all the way to when it enters the ocean at the river mouth. And then that would be your river discharge, that blue line. So what is it? It's the side view. The transverse profile is where we cut that river and we look at it as we chopped it in half. So there between X and Y, there you can see the dotted line. It's the shape of the river valley from one bank to the opposite. So do not get caught in this trap. It can be a cross profile or a transverse profile. That's how it looks. Right, so now, very important, you have a plan view, the stages of a river course and transverse profile. So a longitudinal plan view is if you had to fly over that area of the river, this is what you would see. So the stages of a river course, the upper course or the youth stage, it's a steep slope, it's a steep gradient, the riverbed is uneven, it's energetic, and it's vertical and headward erosion. Remember, that river needs energy, it needs power in order to erode backwards. So the transverse profile, that's how it would look. It's a deep, narrow V-shaped valley with steep slopes. Now, again, what is it? What does it look like? Therefore, you have to be able to draw either plan view or transverse profile. In the middle course or then the mature stage, there's a gradual slope or gradient. You have laminar flow. Things are less energetic. You will have lateral erosion as well as the start of deposition. So can you see that there my slope is a steep slope with that V-shaped valley? Let me quickly just draw it in here. Let's use the purple. So there's my V-shaped valley. And over here, I have that gradual slope. Okay, so there it's a U-shaped valley. So if you had to draw a U, oh goodness, there we go. All right, so it's almost like a wider U-shape. When we get to the lower course or the old age stage, the riverbed is even. It got rid of all of its baggage. It's close to retirement into the ocean. Laminar flow. Okay. Less energetic, less erosion. This river cannot be bothered being destructive. So let's have a look. Now you have your wide, broad valley channel. The rivers are wider. Gentle valley slopes. And this is also where you will find your meander scars, your meanders, your oxbow lakes, your deltas, your braided streams, and so on. Right, how do we determine the course? Now, very important, your exam question papers, unfortunately, won't be in color. So I actually want to quickly go out here. And I want to change this so that you can have a look at so that I can show you how this will look in your exams. Apologies, let me just go back. There we go. Okay, so very important. Okay, but now hang on. Now I've changed the... Okay, I'll just draw it in. Right, I'm current slide. Okay, so this is how what the photo will look like in your question paper. Remember, your photos will be black and white, but our topographic maps are in color. Therefore, we can see the brown, we can see the green, we can see the blue. So in the upper course, over here, we have our riverbed that is uneven. Okay, so there you can see that in the upper course, it's uneven over there. You can see that it's a fast flow. So this over there would be your vegetation. And over here, there's my V-shaped valley. Okay, it's steep slopes. It's steep slopes. There you can see that the river is a little bit darker, but over here, lots of rapids. Okay. And then again, it's that narrow V-shaped valley. Okay. So very important just to point out the reason why I made this photo black and white is the whiter the water appears on a photo, the more turbulent the flow is. In other words, lots of rocks creating disturbances in the river. You'll have a look at the lower course. I might be able to change that one also. And then you'll see that the river appears a lot darker in the middle and the lower course due to it being a more even riverbed. If we have a look at the upper course on the topographic map, you can see that the contour lines are close to each other. Right, you can see that we have a high frequency of contour lines there. They almost look like they are solid brown lines. However, remember, contour lines never, ever, ever will cross. So therefore, we can identify the upper course. You can see that this is where the river has V-shaped valleys. Let me just draw the V-shaped valleys again. So if you have a look over here, there's one. It's a little bit difficult to see whether on the screen. There's another one. There's a nice one over here. Okay. V-shaped valleys. Right. Let's get going to the next course. Oopsie-daisy. Right, in the middle course, now all of a sudden you have a gradual slope. you have lateral erosion, and then you have that open V-shaped valley. Now, before I move further, I'm going to change the photos quickly to show you the how they will look. There we go. So I was in the middle course. Apologies, grade 12s. Thank you. Right. So let's say this was a photo that you get in your exam. You can see that this river over here is darker. Where's my pointer? It's darker than the one we had in the previous slide. You can see that there are farming activities taking place. So over here, they refer to an open V-shaped valley. I like to call it a U, as it's the profile is more rounded. So there's a gradual slope. In map work, along the middle course, you will see that the river starts to meander. You can see that the river starts to bend. The gradual slope, you have orchards and vineyards over here. Therefore, the gradual slope, people can farm. We can have agricultural activities. We can have settlements alongside the river. So the contours are far apart. It's a gradual slope, built up areas. I've mentioned the farming, and we can find infrastructure along the river. In the lower course, again, grade 12s, in the lower course, this one, for example, has the river mouth. But if I've taken out the river mouth, how would you have known that this is the lower course? Have a look at this river. It is winding all the way down to an area, again, with darker water. However, over here, you have lighter areas, which can be the sand or then the waves. So it's almost flat. There's a very gentle slope. And over here, can you see my laser pointer is a bit big, but over here where it is now, it's a lighter gray than over here. So maybe I must just quickly do this. So this area over here is a lighter gray than the one that I'm going to mark in green. And grade 12s, you need to use what we give you. Remember, the darker the river, the more calm the water. In map work, there we go. This is just up the west coast. So there you will have your sandbanks. So the sandbanks over here, the area that I drew in green, the river mouth. So there's the river mouth in green, and there's the river mouth over there. My sandbanks in green that I drew, there are my sandbanks. All right, my deposition. My meanders, there's my river bending and twisting. All right, you can see that I'm trying to look now. I can't even see any brown other than the sandbanks. I can't seem to find a contour line. So therefore, it is almost flat. So it has to be between 0 and 20 meters because I cannot find a contour line. And contour lines are always in intervals of 20 meters on our topographic maps. So few contours, gentle slope, almost flat, marshes, meanders, and then that wide valley channel. All right. Over here, so let's see what you know. So the topographic map extracts A to C show the three courses of the Berg River. All right, so let's see if we can use the WhatsApp chat to complete the table that follows. So take a quick mental snap of what's on the screen now. And let's complete the table. So I want you guys to identify the river course at A. I'm looking for answers. And if you do have a pen and paper with you, kindly send photos of the cross profile that you would draw. I think let's do the river course A quickly. So have a look at river course A. Which course will A be? Which one will B be, and which one will C be? And then I would like you to just send photos of your cross profile of the river in the course at A. I see upper course. That is correct. It is indeed the upper course. But now, if the learner can just tell me three reasons why you say that it's the upper course. Let's see if you've paid attention. So if the learner, you have a fairy next to your name, but I'm hesitant to pronounce your name. Don't you maybe want to phonetically write your name so that I know who you are? So I've got upper course. I've got a reason that the lines are closer together. The contours are close together, meaning that it's steep. There are steep slopes as contour lines are close together. Yes. Carly. Okay, so, all right. Thank you, Carly. Just give me a thumbs up if I'm saying it correct. Thank you, my dear. I appreciate. But now we only have one reason. I need more. I need three reasons. So we've got a lot of learners saying that it's the upper course because the contour lines are close together. Which means, remember, always answer as though you are answering the stupidest person alive. And I'm not calling your teachers or the tutors stupid, but give us as much information so that your answer can be foolproof. That someone that doesn't even take geography will be able to give us the answer. So there's Rusha. Also saying that the lines are close to each other. The river has a V valley shape. It starts at a high point, I think. So this learner has got a lovely view of a river, but unfortunately no name. So why would you say that it starts at a high point? So let's have a look. We have a spot height of 1,126. And if we have a look at the following, there my contour lines are, and it goes down. It goes down. And we also have a lot of tributaries. Okay, there we go. So in the upper course, you have V-shaped valleys and that V points up. Ooh, golly gosh. Now I need to get rid of what I drew there. Let's quickly erase this. I made a boo-boo. Just as life, you can correct your mistakes. So there we go. V-shaped valley. So now grade 12s, this V is basically upside down. But the tip of that V will point towards your increased height. So there's another spot height of 835 meters, and here's one that's 555. So again, have a look. That river will flow from a higher point downwards. Remember, it's only in fancy houses where water goes up because they've got pumps. A river can never, ever, ever flow up. Back in the day, Ratanga Junction managed to make water move, but a river cannot flow up. Let's have a look. Because it's a mountain and a river starts at a mountain. Right, so let's quickly have a look, recap at our three answers. So the contours are close together, therefore indicating a steep slope. We have V-shaped valleys that coincides with the characteristics of the upper course. We have lots of tributaries as well. I think we've covered majority of it. I'm still looking for your sketches. I would like to see the profile. Have a look. Oopsie daisy. So I wanted to ask I need the cross profile of the upper course. Right. So that basically means that C, it's the one that we had just now. So C will be the lower course and B would be the middle course. But I would like sketches of the V-shaped valley. Oh gosh, I've given it away now. I want a sketch of the river in the upper course, and the V-shaped valley is your clue. Oh goodness, Lisa Kanya, upper course, middle course, and lower course. Now, Lisa Kanya, I see there's a blue pen. Do you mind just indicating the river to me? In your book, I just want to see how the river would change in your sketch. So just quickly draw the river for me. How will that river look in the upper course? What will the river do in the middle course? And how will the river look in the lower course? Ooh, someone's laughing at your sketches there. That's not very, very nice. All right, you're getting lots of love there, Lisa Kanya. If you can maybe just give me, or someone else can also use the sketch. And then even in WhatsApp, you can just reply on it and draw on your phone how the river will look. There's another learner, upper course A, middle B, and the lower course E. Well done to this learner also. I'm still looking for the river. So we've asked for the profile, but remember, to the untrained eye, to someone that does not teach geography, will they know that there's a river? You guys have got the profile, but where's the river? And there's a reason why I'm using these sketches, because it's a mistake that a lot of the learners make. We ask you to draw and you just draw the profile, but we need more. You're giving us the skeleton, but we need the flesh. We need the muscles in order to make you strong enough to get the full amount and the full value of your points. Let's see if I can do this. Lisa Kanya, are you still busy drawing your river maybe? Sorry to put you on the spot. Other learner that also posted. Upper course, water, water, water.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am?
Yes?
I think one of the important things also that I'm finding here with my learners now is indicating with the use and of labels.
Yes. Sir, that's exactly what I'm trying to get to.
We probably need to.
Yes, I get you, sir. I was hoping that they would add the labels. There's one learner that drew water. There goes the Okay, Lisa Kanya, you drew the river over there. I'm going to see. I hope everyone has access to the WhatsApp chat. I'm going to attach the image of the river that I would have drawn. Let me just quickly see. There we go. I'm trying to draw on my phone here quickly. It's not going too well. But let's see what I can do here. I'm not very creative, as I've mentioned. But let's see. I would have said a V shape there. I'll explain my answer just now. Goodness, can't spell. I would have actually added the U and the Y. Okay, let's see. There we go. So grade 12s, I've just basically, hang on, I think this is someone from the Afrikaans winter school. So Lisa Kanya, I think this learner is just on the wrong group. So as you can see on Lisa Kanya's original sketch, I just added the river. And what I want you guys to note is, yes, it's on a phone, but I've drawn the cross profile, I've added the river, and I've added in yellow, apologies, the V-shaped valley. I added that the river is narrow. In the middle course, I drew my river a little bit wider. I've indicated that it starts to meander, and I have my wider U shape. In the lower course, my river is winding. It is thicker than, not everywhere, but it's thicker than the river in the middle course. And I even added an oxbow lake to show that I know what happens in the lower course. That you could have even said oxbow lakes due to increased deposition. So I think that's what Mr. Ferreira also mentioned, is remember your labels. So that's absolutely crucial. You'll see later on also, the way I asked the question to my learners, and they never, ever, ever drew, even the stronger learners, the ones that get 90%, and they didn't get it. And the learners that normally struggle, they actually got full marks for the question because they weren't sure what to draw. So they drew everything, and they indicated with labels what they were drawing. And I always tell them, remember, guys, in class, I'm the smartest person ever. When it comes to exams, I become absolutely stupid. Zero brains, not even half a brain cell. So you need to describe and draw exactly how you would explain to someone with no background of geography. All right. Thank you very much, Lisa Kanya. Thank you for being able to scratch all over your drawing. Eco, upper, middle, and lower course. Rapids, starts to meander, and flat plain. Well done. All right. So again, this learner that posted now drew the V shape, but it still, to me, it lacks more content. It lacks more flesh. Right, so I need you guys to always rather add more so that we can mark everything that you have written. Okay. Right, then over here, let's just quickly see. This is what they expected of us. So then the upper course, the contours are close, there are steep slopes, narrow valleys, short tributaries, and you would have vertical erosion. In the middle course, contours are further apart, gradual slope, U-shaped valley, lateral erosion, and then a wider channel. Now, grade 12s, this is what a lot of you drew. You added the water, you added the water, you had the V-shaped valleys. But the content is what was lacking. So yes, this is the drawing, but I need this also. All right. Thank you very much for that. I loved the interaction. Okay, there we go. Right, so this is what I wanted to get to, but all things in life, it does not come easy. All right, so we've identified it, we've given the reasons, and we had our cross profile. Right, now we get to the summary. Very, very, very important. Grade 12s, the cross profile, the features, and then the different landforms. Now, in my sketch in the lower course, I added an oxbow lake. So if we ask you to draw something, every single aspect on this slide, you have your phones. I see a lot of you on the WhatsApp group. Take a photo. Ask your teachers if you can get the slideshow printed. Or even if they have it, they can just keep it up on the screen and you can draw it later when you go back to school again. So you have the profile, you have the features and the processes. So those are all labels that you can add to your sketch. And then the cherry on top for us as markers would be if you can add the landforms. Then I know, goodness, this learner really knows their work. Right, the upper course or the Young River. Let's have a look. I've basically covered a lot of it already. So you, oopsie-daisy, you have your steep, fast-flowing downward erosion, waterfalls, rapids, and then you have your interlocking spurs. So they would be all of these. Right. In the middle course, the more mature river, things start to gradually move a little bit slower. Lateral erosion, meanders and spurs. Then in the lower course, I love this slide. It shows us the braided streams, the meander where the river bends. It shows us the wide flat floodplain. It shows us the marsh, which is our landform, and the river mouth also. And again, there are no contours in sight on this extract, therefore level ground. I mean, just look at this. There's a spot height of 4 meters above sea level. I saw another benchmark here. There we go. 6.5 meters, 6.5 meters above sea level. So it's definitely flat. Right, now, the river grading. So if you achieve good grades, everything goes smoothly. And that's where a river, how can I say, wants to be. It does not want to have rapids. It does not want to have anything obstructing a flow. So we are looking for that smooth concave shape. Again, with the word board, we have river grading. We have base levels of erosion, which I'll get to just now. We have the graded river, and then we have the ungraded river. With our word board definitions, let's have a look at the following. Just quickly want to get all the animations going. Oopsie-daisy. Right. So the river grading, we need a balance between erosion and deposition. Can you see that this line is smooth? Right, then with base levels of erosion, now you have a permanent base level. That's where the river ends, okay? The lowest level to which the river will erode. Over here, you have rapids, you have a lake, and you have waterfalls. So temporary base levels, such as lakes and dams and waterfalls, over time, the rapids will be eroded, and that section over there will be smooth. The lake might not be used anymore, so this section over here will then be eroded, and then you should know how a waterfall forms. So then the hard rock over here and that plunge pool will then be eroded into the smooth concave profile. So just to, oh my gosh, the permanent base level is moved over to the temporary base level. So let's just have a look at the temporary. It's a temporary point. It won't be there forever. And then our permanent base level, that is the lowest level. So what we would like is a balance between our erosion and our deposition. An ungraded river, let me just get all the animations going. Oopsie-daisy. Ungraded river, can you see that it's got a waterfall? So it still has a temporary base level. It's not smooth sailing. Right. So the profile is quite rough. It's not that smooth. So very important, this river has just enough energy to carry the eroded materials. If we have a look at a graded river, nice and smooth. All the temporary base levels have been removed. There are no signs of waterfalls, no sign of a dam, no sign of rapids or anything in this diagram. Right. Oh, goodness. How does a river become a graded river? So you will have vertical erosion. Remember, we need the balance between erosion and deposition. So with vertical erosion in the upper course, steep gradient. Then the vertical erosion will then flatten and remove the rapids. Lakes are then filled with the eroded material. And then headward erosion will remove the waterfall. And then it will retreat and disappear. Ultimately, deposition occurs because close to the river mouth, your slope is gradual. And then eventually, once number 1 to 5 has taken place, the steep slope in the upper course and the gradual slope in the lower course will then lead to the smooth concave shape. Right, river grading, ungraded profile. Can you see it's not smooth sailing from the source to the river mouth? Okay, fluvial landforms. Now you can be asked how they are formed, as well as you can be asked to draw it. So everyone's familiar with the Oxbow Lake. Over here, Meander Scar is a Oxbow Lake that used to be there. There's your floodplain, your meander, your river bend, your braided stream, almost looks like hair that's braided, and then your delta. So the floodplain found in the lower course of the river, it's a flat area, remember the link to map work, and it's adjacent to the river. So in the floodplain area, you would see some settlements and you would see your cultivated land. Okay, so waterfalls, there you have your soft, less resistant rock that's eroded faster. The small steps, so rapids where they increase the turbulence. Again, if I had to change these photos to black and white, this would be darker, smoother flow over the rocks, and there where that rock has created the turbulence, the water would appear whiter. Oxbow Lake on a map. There you can see the Oxbow. So over there, this would become your Oxbow Lake cut off. Okay, so there's one over there, erosion of the neck. The neck will get narrower and ultimately will lead to an oxbow lake where the river has been cut off or cut from the main stream. Right, so I'm just quickly going to go through this question with you. It's a paragraph question where they ask the processes that the profile must undergo to change from an ungraded to a graded profile. So very important. What had to happen in this sketch in order to get the smooth concave profile? So it's kind of like spot the difference. The source has to be there. Over there, there's a rapid. So what had to happen to remove the rapid? What had to happen to remove the waterfall? So we had downward erosion in the upper and the middle course. The slope is steeper. Headward erosion removed the waterfall, for example. The waterfalls retreated. The rapids, all those rocks creating the white water of the rapids were flattened. Lakes filled with the eroded material. We had an increase in the carrying capacity. The gradient in the lower course must decrease. Then our stream had to flow slower, and then our deposition, right? So it's very important. Again, your answers are in front of you, but you just have to know what had to happen over here in order for it to become smooth like this diagram on the right. Right, river rejuvenation. We are almost finished, and then I would like us to just quickly go to the questions. So, our graded river, our rejuvenation, our vertical erosion, isostatic uplift, faulting, river capture, neck point. And if I'm not mistaken, I put the slide in the wrong place. So, grade 12s, we are in fact finished with the slides for today.